kind of what everybody else was a bit baffled about.
Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received apologies from Ruth Maguire for this meeting, and James Dornan is joining us remotely as a substitute. Our second agenda item today is consideration of the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill, Stage 2. As she's member in charge of the bill, Gillian Mackay will not participate in the committee Stage 2 proceedings by virtue of Rule 9.13A2B. Ross Greer is attending in her place as a committee substitute by virtue of Rule 12.2A.2. By virtue of Rule 12.2.3A, Gillian Mackay is participating in the meeting today as the member in charge of the bill. I also welcome the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, and I will briefly explain the procedure we'll be following during today's proceedings for anyone watching. Members should have with them a copy of the bill as introduced. Members should also have the marshalled list of amendments, which sets out the amendments in the order in which they will be disposed of. The groupings of amendments, which sets out the amendments in order in which they will be debated. These documents are available on the Bill web page on the Scottish Parliament's website for anyone observing. There will be one debate on each group of amendments, and in each debate I will call the member who lodged the first amendment in the group to speak to and move that amendment and to speak to all the other amendments in the group. I will then call other members with amendments in the group to speak to but not move their amendments and to speak to other amendments in the group if they wish. I will then call any other members who wish to speak in the debate. Members wishing to speak should indicate by catching mine or the clerk's attention. I will then call the member in charge of the bill and then the minister if they've not already spoken in the debate. Finally, I will call the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up and to indicate whether he or she wishes to press the amendment or to withdraw it. If the amendment is pressed, I will put the question on the amendment. Later amendments in a group are not debated again when they are reached. If they are moved, I will put the question on them straight away. If a member wishes to withdraw an amendment after it has been moved and debated, I will ask whether any other member wishes to press. And if they object. If there is an objection, I will immediately put the question on the amendment. If any member does not wish to move their amendment when it's called, they should say not moved. And in this situation, any other member present may move the amendment. If no one moves it, I will immediately call the next amendment on the marshalled list. If there is a division, only committee members are entitled to vote. Voting is by a show of hands. It is important that members keep their hands raised clearly until clerks have recorded their names. The committee is also required to consider and decide on each section and schedule of the bill and the long title. I will put the question on each of these provisions at the appropriate point. And I call Amendment 42 in the name of Rachel Hamilton in a group on its own. Rachel Hamilton to move and speak to Amendment 42.
And thank you to the committee for welcoming me, convener. And I just want to say that I was part of the pre-working group with the First Minister, which I attended twice on abortion buffer zones. Amendment 42 inserts a purpose clause at the start of the bill, which sets out aims and intentions of the bill. It outlines the purpose of the bill to ensure that a person seeking safe access to abortion services or a healthcare worker providing this essential healthcare should be able to access and provide abortion services without fear of intimidation or harassment. I believe that this amendment strengthens the bill by specifically outlining the purpose on the face of the bill and provides clarity and ensures that it remains defined and focused. And I move the amendment in my name. Thank you, convener.
Thank you, Ms. Hampton. Carol Morgan.
Thank you, convener. The Scottish Labour position is that this is a reasonable amendment. However, we're not sure it's particularly necessary in this part of the bill, as the intention is throughout the bill. So we just wanted to place that on the record.
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, convener. And thank you to committee members for your Stage 1 consideration. This is a complex subject area and I'm grateful to the sensitive and thoughtful way that you have all approached it, and I look forward to a similar discussion this morning. Turning directly to Amendment 42, My reasons for asking committee to vote against it are largely practical. Purpose clauses in Scottish legislation historically have only been used in exceptional circumstances, and there must be compelling reasons for their inclusion, as I note Carol Mochan has raised. Although I'm grateful for Ms Hamilton for setting out her reasons for seeking to do so in this bill, I am concerned that the inclusion of such a clause may have consequences that would go beyond what she has set out this morning. The purpose of any bill, no matter the complexity of the subject matter or the rights impacted, is to change the law, and every section should further that aim. This isn't simply a semantic argument about good drafting. It goes to the heart of how bills are applied in the whole world. All sections should have a clear legal effect and be capable of interpretation by a court. And that being so, a section that's not intended to have a legal effect should not be included. That means that bills are not the place to set out policy intent or ambition. For that, there are other opportunities, such as policy or strategy documents. Conversely, including a section means we must accept that it may in future be expected to have legal effect. A purpose clause must therefore be subject to the most careful drafting to ensure that it does not conflict with the other sections of the bill. Without doing so, there is a risk that its legal effect might conflict with the powers and duties in the bill, or be read as serving an additional legal test for the exercise of duties. For example, in this instance, the purpose refers to fear and intimidation, and these differ from the offences set out in sections 4 and 5 and the tests in sections 7 and 8, setting out when it's appropriate for ministers to extend or reduce a zone. Its inclusion could therefore introduce uncertainty around how ministerial powers to reduce or extend a zone could be exercised, or in how the courts interpret the offence provisions. These are significant uncertainties to introduce. Therefore, if the purpose is not intended to have legal effect, it should not be included. And I urge Ms Hamilton not to press it. If it is intended to have legal effect, then I must urge committee to vote against it on the grounds that it may, at best, create uncertainty over how the law is to work in practice and, at worst, be interpreted in ways that result in the law being implemented in a manner that was never intended.
Thank you, Minister. Gillian Mackay.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you. Like the Minister, I also offer my thanks for committee's work so far, and I know we will not all reach the same conclusions this morning, but I also know we will do so respectively and collegiately. And I'm hopeful we'll achieve a stronger bill by the end. I want to thank Rachel Hamilton for her engagement with myself and her desire to collaborate to make the bill better. Other than that, Convener, I don't have anything further to add to what the Minister said.
Thank you. Ms Hamilton, to wind up.
Thank you, Convener. From the outset, I have been concerned that women have been put off accessing healthcare, which could be a danger to their health. And that has been described to me by the charity Back Off Scotland. And I want to speak to Carol Mochan's comment there. There has always been an argument that a purpose clause is not necessary, but to Carol Mochan's point, her own party bring forward purpose clauses in the context of other bills and argue that they are the right thing to do to make the bill clear. I know that the bill has been controversial amongst many, and I merely seek to bring the focus towards women's health, because I think women's health has been in danger of. We've been in danger of letting them down because of this situation. To the Minister's point, if there is legal concern, would the Minister work with me to get the wording right if she's concerned specifically about the reference to the fear of intimidation or harassment? Because I do think a purpose clause would seek to clarify the point that we're trying to make, which is to strengthen women's health and access to women's health services.
Minister wants to intervene.
I thank Ms Hamilton for that proposal. However, as I laid out in my arguments for the committee to reject it, I am concerned about the dubiety that it does raise, and where we have used purpose clauses before, they're not used generally, but where we have, for example, in the UK withdrawal from the EU Continuity Scotland Act, it was included to make clear that the bill did not apply until the UK left the EU. I think we've been very clear with all our policy documents about this, that this bill is being introduced to ensure that women can access healthcare safely, without intimidation, without fear of harassment. And I think that's clear within the bill and all our policy notes that support it.
OK, thank you to the Minister for that. But thank you. But I mean, I'm a bit disappointed that you won't work with me to get those words right so that it is legally competent. But I will be pressing. Thank you.
OK, thank you very much for confirming that. The question is that Amendment 42 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
OK, so the committee will move to a vote. OK, so those in favour, please raise your hands. Those against? James Dolan's on the line. And abstentions? So the result of Amendment 42 is those 4, 1, against 5 and 2 abstentions. Therefore, the amendment falls. I call Amendment 6 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 7, 15, 16, 35, 36, 37 and 38. Minister to move Amendment 6 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I will address Amendments 6, 7, 15 and 16 quickly. These are draft improvements. Amendment 6 clarifies that protected premises may refer to a building that is, contains or forms part of a hospital and that the building must provide abortion services. Amendment 15 also reflects this change, and Amendment 7 and 16 improve the wording of those provisions. I will approach the amendments to Section 10, Amendments 35 to 38 together. Firstly, my Amendment 36 provides flexibility in how the definition of protected premises may be modified. As introduced, Section 10 allowed the definition to be extended to cover places approved as a class of place under Section 1(3) of the 1960 Abortion Act. So, for example, if GP practices were approved as abortion providers, they could all be covered by a zone. And places providing treatments of services relating to abortion services. So, for example, that a zone could be established around a building which provided counselling related to abortion treatment. With these provisions, if a class of place were approved under the Abortion Act 1967, ministers could not extend the definition of protected premises in this bill to include only individual premises that were part of a class of place. So, to continue my example, if GP practices were approved as abortion providers, but not all practices offered the service, ministers could not establish a zone solely around those that needed it. Instead, they would have to extend the definition to include all practices. This would cover more providers than necessary. And I'm grateful to Dr. Gulhani for drawing attention to this issue. The amendment I have brought forward responds directly to points he made at the evidence session on the 19th of March. The amendment provides that ministers can now extend the definition to cover individual premises within a class of place approved under the 1967 Act. This gives greater flexibility and is proportionate. However, if required, the whole class of place can be added. As ministers must always act proportionately, they will be bound to use the less restrictive option where the evidence supports the aim of protecting women and staff. I hope members will agree that this is a positive step that ensures the bill is future-proofed, whilst also reflecting the Government's obligation to always act proportionately. I will now turn to Dr. Gulhani's and Mr. Balfour's amendments. Given what I have set out, I hope you will not be surprised to hear that I am resisting both. With Amendment 38, Dr. Gulhani seeks to entirely remove the potential to extend the definition of protected premises. As I set out to committee during my evidence, by including this section, we will ensure we pass legislation that is capable of protecting women, not just this year or next, but in years and maybe even decades to come. It means that women and staff will be able to access services even if treatments or delivery models change, and it provides scope to respond if the behaviour of groups who oppose abortion and the venues they target change. If anyone doubts that this is necessary, I would ask them to reflect on the history of abortion care since the 1967 Act was passed. When the Abortion Act came into force, having an abortion meant undergoing a surgical procedure. Now, for many women, having an abortion involves visiting a clinic to collect tablets which they can take at home. We have no idea what care will look like in the future, but it would certainly be unwise to assume it will remain as it is now. Likewise, while I hope it doesn't happen, we cannot rule out that the ways in which anti-abortion groups will seek to target those having abortions will stop evolving. A decade ago, we did not see the kinds of activity in Scotland we do now, and whilst I will not labour the point, we have seen how anti-abortion groups have mobilised to strike at abortion provision in the United States in ways we would not have imagined possible. We must make sure we are able to respond if we need to, although, of course, always ensuring that we act compatibly with the European Convention of Human Rights. Section 10 does not threaten any broader rights to protest. It could only ever be used to protect women and staff at the point where they are accessing or providing services. I do, of course, understand that the prospect of covering all GP practices or pharmacies could be significant, and committee members may have concerns about that. I do not want to dismiss that, but I will provide reassurance. Firstly, the examples I have given are purely illustrative. There are no plans to approve pharmacies or GP practices as classes of place under the Abortion Act 1967. As I said earlier, we have no idea what the future might bring. A class of place approval may never be granted, or it may be granted for a very small set of premises. What Section 10 does is ensure that we can act if we need to, and the Government Amendment has ensured that the protection can be extended to only those premises where it's actually needed. Second, any decision to extend the definition will be evidence-based, and the Scottish Ministers must always act compatibly with the European Convention on Human Rights. Because of that, no additional protected premises can be added unless ministers are satisfied that it would be proportionate. They would have to balance protecting the Article 8 rights of women and staff with any interference to Articles 9, 10 and 11 rights. Again, this underlines the significance of the Government Amendment if protecting only individual premises rather than an entire class of premise would achieve the Bill's aims. Ministers would be duty-bound to do only that. Thirdly, ministers cannot act unilaterally. Any change to the definition of protected premises using Section 10 will require affirmative regulations. The Scottish Parliament will therefore be able to scrutinise the necessity and proportionality of the designation of any new protected premises. If Parliament is not satisfied that ministers have met their obligations or that the evidence to modify the definition is not sufficient, then the regulations could be voted down. Convener, my reasons for not supporting Mr. Balfour's amendments 35 and 37 are very similar. In the event that GP practices or pharmacies are approved as a class of place, we must be able to extend protection to them if that is needed. As I have said, there are no plans to do this. Nevertheless, it is illogical to exclude them when there is a possibility that they could be approved as a class of place for the provision of abortion services and then targeted in the future. I do recognise the concern that underpins these amendments, and I do hope that the Government's Amendment 36 will provide reassurance that we have also considered this matter and have taken steps to ensure that the least restrictive approach will be taken. I move the amendments in my name.
Thank you, Minister. Jeremy Balfour to speak to Amendment 35 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Good morning to the committee and to the Minister and to Julia Mackay. Most of the amendments I'm moving today are probing amendments to see where both the government and the member is in regard to them. And certainly in regard to Amendment 35 and 37, I'll say at this stage that I won't be pressing them, but I am grateful for the debate that we've had and for the tone of the debate so far in regard to the debate. The point of these two amendments is to seek to limit the expansion of the definition of a protected premises. I don't think it is unreasonable to suggest that pharmacies and primary care clinics, like GP surgeries, should be omitted from the law. While I understand that these places can provide take-home services, it is not their primary function. And in fact, it's rare that they are giving out these services compared to other prescriptions and care that they provide. I think there is a balance which the committee recognised within their Stage 1 report and the government of there is absolutely the right for women to feel safe and protected, but also there is the right for free speech and for that to be. And in my view, we have to get that correct. Convener, there are 900 GP surgeries in Scotland and over 1,200 pharmacies, with most of them being on our high streets. To expand the definition of a protected premises to include all of these, we'd shut down every one of these high streets to any form of demonstration, store or even possible conversation. I absolutely accept the Minister's comments that she has no intention to do this, but as she did make the point in her speech, we are future-proofing this bill for future generations, and there may be another government that comes down the road which may want to do this for perhaps not the appropriate reasons. A lot of my amendments have, because I'm a Lothian member, Lothian in Edinburgh, in mind when I'm dealing with this. So, for example, Boots on Prince's Street, if this was to become a protected place, would mean there could be no demonstration in Prince Street Gardens, on George Street and other parts of our city centre because of the 200-metre rule. Now, this bill is trying to walk a fine line between ensuring women can access these services while upholding the rights of freedom of speech, expression and religion. Now, I believe the way forward for this is to exclude pharmacies and GPs at the moment. If, as the Minister pointed out, things change in the future and Parliament want to revisit this, then they can do that through any amendments or a fresh bill coming forward. I am concerned that many of our city centres is where the GP and where the surgeries are, and we would be taking out vast amounts of areas where legal demonstrations may not be allowed to take place. So I will reflect on what the Minister has said and others say and reflect on that before Stage 3. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. Sandish Gulhani to speak to Amendment 35 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you,
Convener. 38. Apologies.
Thank you, Convener. And Declaration of Interest as a practising NHS GP. And I'd like to thank the Minister for her remarks as well. This is not a debate on abortion, and I very firmly believe that women have a right to access healthcare without fear or intimidation. And so with that, Amendment 38 seeks to remove Section 10 of the bill. And it's my position that the definition of protected premises should not be capable of modification by way of secondary legislation. My concern is that if there are changes to abortion service delivery and new settings, such as pharmacies and GP surgeries, as we heard earlier, and they're approved to provide abortion services under the 1967 Act, the safe access zones could be established around them, taking the extent and number of zones beyond what is reasonable and proportionate. We could see safe access zones covering significantly larger areas than the initial 30 sites. GP surgeries, we go to pharmacies, we could even be talking about Amazon warehouses potentially in the future. Now, and whilst I do acknowledge that the bill requires consultation with the provider, the operator, and where considered appropriate, the health board and local authority, I do not consider that there is sufficient scrutiny for such potential wide-reaching consequences. Modification of the meaning of protected premises should only happen by way of primary legislation with full parliamentary scrutiny. And as the Minister says, we do not know what abortion care will look like in the coming decades. Committee members will recall Stage 1 report highlighting the future extension of this definition is likely to have an impact on the human rights set out in Articles 9, 10 and 11 of the European Convention on Human Rights to protest or undertake vigils. The Stage 1 report recommended that any changes to the definition should be subject to a further advanced level of parliamentary scrutiny that's currently provided in the bill. The deletion of Section 10 removes the power of Scottish ministers to amend the definition, requiring them to bring forward new primary legislation, in other words, full parliamentary scrutiny. Now, remember, governments can change, and a future government may extend despite the minister saying right now that this is not the intention. I genuinely believe that this extension is a significant change, should it happen, and significant change requires significant scrutiny. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gohani. Carol Morgan.
Thank you, I want to thank the Minister for her time and discussion in this particular area. Scottish Labour have taken a great deal of time to go over this because, as both Dr. Gohani and Jeremy Balfour have said, this would be significant but important. And so, on balance, we believe that the care in the future does need to be part of this bill because things have changed for women in this area of healthcare, and so it's important that we can do that in a timely manner should it be needed. So we believe that the bill, as it's set out with the amendments from government, would be sufficient to make sure that we are getting that balance of human rights in terms of the restrictions that any additional zones might add, and that it would be fair to allow the Minister to do that. So we will be supporting the Minister's amendments, but Amendment 37 and 38 we will be voting against because we do believe it is better for the Minister to be able to act on these things and that the bill does have a good balance. Thank you.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay.
Vina, I'm grateful to the Minister for the amendments she's lodged. In particular, I'm fully supportive of the increased flexibility that Amendment 36, if accepted by the committee, will provide if there is a need to protect additional kinds of premises in the future. As I've always said, my aim is to protect women and staff, and I do not wish to infringe on other rights any more than necessary, and I'm pleased this amendment will allow a targeted approach if appropriate. I also support the Minister in urging members to vote against Amendments 35, 37 and 38. I've been appreciative of Mr Gilhani's consideration throughout this process. As the Minister noted, he prompted reflection on the scope of Section 10 in the bill as introduced and the lodging of Amendment 36. However, I cannot agree that we should pass this bill as if services will remain static and behaviour will never change. Likewise, I agree with the Minister's comments on Amendment 35 and 37. Parliament will have a prominent role in scrutinising any expansion to the definition of protected premises, and therefore it seems extremely ill-advised to tie our hands by ruling out specific kinds of premises, regardless of circumstance. Others this morning have mentioned reopening primary legislation and amending it. That will, as everybody knows, take time, where women will be being intimidated or harassed all over again. This is particularly the case when, as already discussed, Amendment 36 also means individual premises can be specified if that's more appropriate. For example, where only certain premises provide the services and a blanket approach is not necessary. I want women and staff in the future to benefit from the protections we're considering here today, and I hope that the committee will agree.
Minister, to wind up.
Convener, I hope members agree that there needs to be an element of future-proofing, as Carol Malkin said, which will allow the bill to continue to achieve its aims even if abortion treatments or the way services are provided change. And as I've explained, should these powers be used, they will always be subject to parliamentary oversight, as Ms Mackay has emphasised as well. I'd like to thank Mr Balfour for his contribution and tone. And if I heard him correctly, you're not intending to press your amendment. So I thank him for that. I'm very happy to have further conversations with him prior to stage three. So I hope the combined the arguments that I've just laid out, combined with the improvement to be made by Amendment 36, is sufficient to convince Dr. Gulhani and Mr. Balfour not to press their amendments. I thank Mr. Balfour for noting that he won't. However, if Dr. Gulhani does, I urge members not to vote for his. Doing so will preserve the ability for the legislation to be relevant and fit for purpose in years to come. I move my amendments.
The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We are all agreed. I call Amendment 7 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 6. Minister, to move formally.
Move.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 8 in the name of the Minister, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Minister, to move Amendment 8 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Get the right page of my file, my tome, my apologies. Convener, the Scottish Government proposes amendments numbered 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 32, 40 and 41 in relations to sections 2, 7, 8 and 13 of the Bill. The Bill establishes safe access zones around premises in Scotland which provide abortion services. Therefore, it is important that the way in which safe access zones are described is accurate and easy to understand. It is proposed that a safe access zone will exist around a premises which provides abortion services, and this is called the protected premises. The zone, therefore, consists of the protected premises, the public area of the grounds of the protected premises, and the public area of land that lies within a boundary measured from those grounds. The ability for legislation to be understood by the reader is key to good law. In between the Bill being published and Stage 2, I've taken the opportunity to review the wording of the Bill and have identified some areas where there is unnecessary duplication of words or areas which could be simplified. Overall, the proposed amendments in this group are designed to make it easier to understand how a safe access zone is defined and measured. Amendments 8, 10, 28 and 29 remove unnecessary repetitive wording. Amendments 12 and 40 remove the term edge of the protected premises. That term will be replaced by way of amendments 14 and 41, which introduce a new defined term of protected site. Again, the reason for this is to improve clarity and avoid repetition of words. There has been no change in policy. Instead, these changes help explain that the protected site is made up of the protected premises together with its grounds. Amendment 13 clarifies the definition of grounds. And as a consequence of the change of the wording protected site, Amendments 9, 11, 26, 27, 30 and 32 replace edge of protected premises with boundary of the protected site throughout the Bill. I understand Ms Harper will speak to amendments in her name and I will address those when I wind up this group. Thank you.
Emma Harper to speak to Amendment 44 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to everybody. I'm pleased to move these amendments in my name. These amendments are not controversial and I hope that members will agree that they're useful in helping to provide clarity around the established safe access zones in Scotland. Amendments 44 and 45 both remove the need for Scottish ministers to publish the list of safe access zones after updating it with new protected premises, because the list will already be published. And this amendment will ensure that Scottish ministers are required to maintain the list and ensure details are up to date. This will ensure clear and proper communication with the public to ensure that everyone is clear around where the safe access zones are. These amendments strengthen the requirement that a safe access zone cannot take effect until at least 14 days after the list is updated, by adding in a new subsection of the Bill to make it easier to identify Similarly, amendments 47 and 48 remove from sections 7 and 8 respectively the need to publish the list when the list is updated following an extension or reduction of safe access zones. This is because, again, the list is already published. The timescales for the revised zone size taking effect remains unchanged, but are put in a new subsection in both sections 7 and 8. It is 14 days after the list is updated for an extension, but the day of the list being updated for reduction. Although these amendments do not have a policy impact, they're nonetheless important changes to make the bill clearer and more easily understood. It is, of course, always a guiding principle that this Parliament must pass laws that are accessible and comprehensible to the people they impact. But in this case, where the issues in play are so challenging and of such personal significance, that duty must be at the forefront of our minds. Finally, during the stage one scrutiny of this bill, I was interested in ministerial oversight of the creation, extension or reduction of safe access zones, and I welcome conversations which I have had with Gillian Mackay, MSP, in this regard. So I hope members can support these amendments, which will help make the bill clearer. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. I'll be brief here because I support these amendments and I'm grateful for the improvements they've made to the draft and encourage members to vote for the amendments in this group. In particular, I want to thank Ms Harper, not just for her amendments, which I believe add clarity, but for her support over the years. I know she's long championed this issue and I'm grateful for her part in this process today.
Minister, to wind up.
I welcome Emma Harper's amendments, which are clearly aimed at ensuring this important piece of legislation is able to be understood by everyone who may be subject to its content. As members have heard, all amendments in this group are not contentious. However, they do have the same aim, which is to provide clarity. I therefore ask members to support all amendments in this group and vote for them. I move Amendment 8.
The question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Call Amendment 43 in the name of Rachel Hamilton in a group in its own. Rachel Hamilton to move and speak to Amendment 43.
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 43 reduces the safe zone distance to 150 metres from the 200 metres currently set out in the bill. In stage one of the committee report, the committee questioned why the default radius of safe access zones had been set at 200 metres. When evidence suggests a radius of 150 metres would be sufficient for all but one, the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital. So the committee then therefore recommended an alternative approach of setting a standard radius of 150 metres for safe access zones in Scotland, and then using the provisions set out in Section 7 of the bill could extend this radius to address the specific circumstances of the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital, which would mean that all protected premises currently providing abortion services in Scotland were covered. I would be interested to hear the arguments made by the Minister why a 200 metre zone is required, given that the Minister has powers to extend that zone. And my concern is that there will be unintended consequences of those captured within this more extreme version of an abortion buffer zone that is more extreme than anywhere else across the world. My concern ultimately is that whilst we want to deliver enforcement of the law, the impact on freedom of speech needs to be proportionate, and this is about medical services and not any other services that could be affected unintentionally. Thank you.
Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Rachel Hamilton, for the start to the debate, because we have obviously considered this at length, given that it was spoken about in the committee sessions, and we have come to the conclusion that we would support the government in this position, mainly because the responses did indicate that this was an important matter and that 200 metres did mean that we would have safe access zones for women in particular premises, as you say, in Scotland, and might be helpful in the future. So we are content to support continue to support the government, so we wouldn't support this amendment. Of course.
Thanks for your explanation there, which I don't really believe that the impact of the assessment has been done on the unintended consequences of others being captured in the 200 metres when currently the committee recognises that there is already ministerial powers in place to extend from 150 metres, which is already almost a standard buffer zone across the United Kingdom, less so Northern Ireland, but it is probably the farther end of the most extreme measurement in the world.
Thank you. Yeah, I absolutely accept the member's point, and it is one of those situations that we have. We have gone back and forward, with people in terms of those who consulted with the committee. So I absolutely accept the member's position. We have to make a decision on it. And so at this stage, we've decided that we would be content with the 200 metres.
Minister.
I am aware that Ms Mackay intends to provide a full and detailed response, so I will simply affirm that the Scottish Government's position aligns entirely with hers. In-depth work has been undertaken to ensure the bill sets a zone size that takes into account the specific circumstances of individual premises and thereby provides adequate protection while remaining proportionate. To accept Amendment 43 would be to strike at the bill's heart without reasonable justification. It would represent bad lawmaking, as the legislation would not be fit for purpose because the zones would not be the necessary size. Yes?
Does the Minister not believe that the powers set out within the bill are sufficient to extend the zones? Because obviously the 200 metres, as suggested, is a minimum.
We, in pulling the bill together and deciding on 200 metres, we have been doing a huge amount of in-depth work, looking at every single facility in Scotland that provides abortions, to ensure that the entry points into these locations are covered. In some locations, including, I believe, one in Ms Hamilton's constituency, 150 metres wouldn't be large enough to cover the area that we believe we need to ensure that women and the staff can access abortion clinics safely and without harassment.
With respect, Convener, if I may come back to the Minister, that wasn't what I asked. I asked, does the Minister believe that the powers set out within the bill are sufficient to extend anything beyond 200 metres, because that circumstance could arise, whether it's 150 or 200 metres.
So I believe we're right to have the 200 metre limit. And what I gave in evidence to the committee in stage one was that gives a consistency so that people understand when the bill is first introduced that that's what they're looking at. I don't want to undermine the tremendous work that this committee has done on this issue so far.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. I recognise the need to restrict the rights of those who wish to take part in anti-abortion activity outside services no more than is absolutely necessary. If I thought this amendment could be safely included and the bill still provide the protections necessary, I'd gladly encourage committee to vote for it. However, as outlined at stage one, considerable work was undertaken between the consultation and the bill being introduced to ensure that the zones were the right size. At the stage one debate, I noted that we identified that we needed to address factors that could provide a captive audience. That work contributed to the size of the zone being 200 metres. Therefore, accepting this amendment would, to a very large extent, render safe access zones somewhat ineffective from day one. The Stage 1 report refers to scoping work showing that 150 metres is sufficient for all but one premises. As I acknowledged during my Stage 1 remarks, I also consulted on 150 metres. This was in line with the size of zones then in place in a number of other jurisdictions. However, the consultation rightly did not mark the end of the work around this issue. During the bill development, the size of the zone was rigorously examined to ensure it could meet the aims of the bill while also remaining proportionate. Convener, that was a vital process, and I can assure all members that had that work shown that 150 metres was more than necessary, then the size of the zones would have been 150 metres. I am repeating much of what I've already said, but we assessed the sites for all protected premises and identified places where those accessing or provided services would be captive audience. For example, entrances and exits, the nearest bus stops and the places where activity has already had negative impacts. We also concluded there must be a buffer around each place to ensure women and staff could not be easily called to or shown images. This made it very clear that 150 metres would not be sufficient for a number of premises beyond the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital. For example, both the Borders General Hospital and Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary. In fact, this amendment would mean that at more than one third of sites, women would not receive the protection they require and the Bill's aims would not be met. Therefore, I must in the strongest terms urge committee members to vote against this amendment. Thank you.
Mackay's summary, just, could I intervene?
Well, she's just finished, Miss Hamilton, and yeah, I'm about to come to you to wind up. And
okay, well, I'll make my points in winding up, thank you. I didn't want to interrupt because I was interested in full description of what she had to say. I accept what Gillian Mackay has had to say on this specific subject, but my argument still remains that there are powers within the bill to extend these zones, and I think that's important because we don't know how this bill is going to shape itself and develop as we go forward, because buildings change size, they become smaller, they become larger, and I think having one size where there's 200 metres where it's not necessary is going to capture other people with an unintended consequence for those. Yes.
Yeah. Does the member have specific scenarios or specific examples of facilities in Scotland at this point in time where she has concerns?
So it would be, for example, the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, where there were other facilities around that specific area that were encompassed in that. And I didn't feel as though I had enough information to reassure me that there wouldn't be unintended consequences for the impact. And the I appreciate the work that the committee's done on this. It's obviously been something that you've looked at very closely. However, in terms of that impact and that unintended consequence and the proportionality, I felt that I needed more information, and that's why I brought this amendment to the fore.
You mentioned the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital in Glasgow, but the consultation response we received from BPAS specifically cited the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital and that particular location on Hargate Road, which is the southern access route to the hospital, as being an issue of concern whereby a 150-metre radius would not be sufficient to deny gathering space where it would be unavoidable for people accessing the hospital. Is that not, in fact, an issue that justifies the 200-metre baseline?
Yeah, I mean, Paul Sweeney will know that I'm 100% supportive of this bill. I just wanted to tease out some of the areas that I felt had been, just for me, the boxes hadn't been ticked, if you like. But I accept what Gillian Mackay said. I won't be pressing my amendment, convener, but I still have concerns around the reassurance that I haven't received from the minister around the use of ministerial powers to extend the zones. Thank you.
Thank you. So Rachel Hamilton seeks to withdraw Amendment 43. Does any member object to that amendment being withdrawn? Thank you. The question is that Amendment 8 be... Oh, we've done that, sorry, apologies. So Amendment 43 has been withdrawn. The question is that Section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Oh, sorry. I call amendments... Apologies. I call amendments 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 and 14 all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated, and I invite the Minister to move amendments 9 to 14 on block. Does any member object to a single question being put to amendments 9 to 14? No. Okay. So the question is that amendments 9 to 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. And the question is that Section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Can't. Call Amendment 15 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 6. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, convener.
The question is that Amendment 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 16 in the name of the Minister. Already debated.
Convener, sorry, we need to move.
I did that?
No, we didn't. We went back.
So we haven't actually asked that question.
I think I did. But I'm happy to go back. The question is that section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yes. I'll check the OR. I'm pretty sure I did. The question is that amendment 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that amendment 44... I'll call amendment 44 in the name of Emma Harper, already debated with amendment 8. Emma Harper, to move or not move?
Moved, please.
The question is that amendment 44 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call amendment 45 in the name of Emma Harper, already debated with amendment 8. Emma Harper, to move or not move?
Move, convener.
The question is that amendment 45 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call amendment 51 in the name of Megan Gallagher in a group on... Oh, the question is that section 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call amendment 51 in the name of Megan Gallagher in a group on its own. Megan Gallagher, to move and speak to amendment 51.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, committee, and to the Minister and Gillian Mackay. And we have had quite a bit of conversation about signage, and I was grateful for the opportunity to meet with the Minister and Gillian Mackay regarding signage. The intent of the amendment would clearly mark the safe access zones for the protected premises and summarise the restrictions that would apply by virtue of this Act within the safe access zones. I understand the reasonings for not including signage in the initial drafting of the bill. I understand this is about protecting women and not drawing close attention to where buffer zones are in place. However, I do still have some concerns relating to the understanding of where a buffer zone would begin with in that 200 mile radius. I think signage would... Sorry, 200 metre radius. Signage, of course, would enable clear distinctions of buffer zones, and I think that would allow for people to clearly understand where a buffer zone would begin and not begin. And I do want to stress that it's 200 metres, not 200 miles. I understand as well that health boards can install signage if they do want to within their own health board area. However, I do want to probe this amendment further to just allow for a more open debate. I understand that committee did do a lot of work on this particular area as well, but maybe to get more of an understanding from the Minister as to whether this could be something that we could look at further or not.
Carol Malkin.
Thank you, convener. I'll just come in briefly. I really appreciate Megan Gallagher's contribution. I have also had a great deal of discussion with the Minister and with Member Gillian Mackay, and I understand the arguments for and against signage. On balance, we believe at this point that health boards do have the option to do that themselves, and it may be something that they would understand their particular premises best, and so we would be content that that would be the best option. So we'll vote if it's pressed against the amendment, but absolutely understand why it's been brought to the stage 2 debate.
Tess White.
Thank you, convener. I would actually like Labour to reconsider, and everybody, for the sake of clarity. I think this amendment's really important for clarity and then enforcing it. If you don't have proper signage, it's very, very difficult to enforce, and leaving it up to the health boards I don't think is good enough. So the financial memorandum states there's currently no requirement in the bill for signage to be displayed outside a protected premises, and there's no expectation at present for any signage to be required. I do appreciate, and I remember the Minister giving evidence to the committee at stage 1, and we did have a discussion about signage, and it would be ongoing. Amendment 51 seems to actually give sufficient flexibility, and I don't think it's particularly prescriptive or onerous. And I note, too, it includes regulation-making powers for Scottish ministers. So that's why I would encourage the committee to reconsider, review and have signage in the bill. Thank you.
Minister.
Thank you, convener. I know from conversations that I've had with Ms. Gallagher on this issue that she has not brought this amendment forward lightly and is aware of the complexities around the issue. Ms. Mackay will also speak about these complexities, in particular the concerns of service providers, so I will say only that I too have these concerns and I share Ms. Mackay's hesitancy to overrule service providers when there is some doubt as to the effectiveness of signage. I do want to talk about what the bill already requires and how that will be supplemented by the Scottish Government. Together, this already represents a considerable package of efforts to ensure those affected by zones will be made aware of them and their effects. Firstly, as ministers are aware, the bill already requires that the Scottish ministers, firstly, as members are aware, the bill already requires that the Scottish ministers publish and maintain a list of all safe access zones in Scotland. This includes not only the name and address of every premises, but also a map which clearly identifies the zone. We know that anti-abortion groups tend to be well organised, often relying on online engagement to share information and plan activity, and therefore we believe this represents a robust means of drawing attention to zones. The Scottish Government has also committed to a targeted publicity campaign. This includes writing to known anti-abortion groups to make them aware of safe access zones and the criminal sanctions that will attach to activity that would result in an offence. We continue to work through the details of the full campaign, but it's likely to also involve leaflet drops to residents within the zone and notices in public venues, such as GP surgeries. Finally, Police Scotland have told us of the approach they would anticipate taking to policing zones. This involves a graduated response, beginning with engagement, explanation and encouragement before any enforcement action would be taken. For all these reasons, I'm of the view that signage would do little to raise awareness of zones that will not be achieved by other means, and that therefore the amendment in general is unnecessary. I do, of course...
Maybe at the end.
I'm happy to take now.
Thank you. Minister, you spoke of hesitancy. Could you outline that a little bit more clearly as to what exactly you're concerned about? And my other question is, have you taken legal advice as to, without clearly defining where that is for the people on the ground, whether that would then be a reason, you know, if I'm standing 190 metres instead of 200, would that be something that could be used in defence of the people who are protesting?
So I've just laid out for what Police Scotland would do in situations like that. And I think my hesitancy is around what health boards, health providers feel is the appropriate level of information to inform people where the zones begin. And as I've pointed out, we believe that the Scottish Government is working towards having very good information to ensure that that happens. But if I may go on, I do, of course, recognise that we must do everything practical to make the law clear to those it may impact. I would welcome the opportunity to undertake further exploration of this issue with Ms. Gallagher and Ms. White if they are willing. And I hope that they both, I hope that Ms. Gallagher will not press her amendment to allow that work to happen. However, if the amendment is pressed, I hope the committee will vote against it.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and I thank the Minister for her contribution and would like to note that I support everything she's said. It's not necessary for me to repeat the particular concerns the Minister raised with the amendment, but I do have some more general concerns with a specific requirement for signage, and these won't be new to Ms Gallagher because it's things we've already discussed. As committee heard during its evidence, signage is not a straightforward matter. During the extensive engagement with service providers ahead of the bill's introduction, a consistent message has been the concerns that signs will draw attention to abortion services that might otherwise go unnoticed. As has been discussed a number of times since the bill's introduction, this may present a particular challenge where women and staff are especially anxious about being identified, for example, in rural areas with small sites. It is, of course, the case that zones must be publicised, and the Minister's already spoken of the steps that will be taken to do so. However, signs would be an ongoing physical demarcation. They'd be visible to every passerby, not just to those who may wish to organise or attend planned anti-abortion activity. Part of the concern, therefore, is that they could provoke more ad hoc, sporadic instances of targeting. And in light of some of the genuinely horrific stories from other countries, there's palpable anxiety amongst some staff about erecting such a permanent advertisement. I accept that these concerns must be weighed up against what is fair and necessary for those who may wish to express opposition to abortion outside services. However, for me it remains unclear that signs themselves will provide the clarity that Ms Gallagher seeks. In the first instance, as even those opposed to the bill noted during stage one, it's not clear that they are a useful method of demarcating a zone. For example, it's not practical or desirable to display signs around the entire perimeter of a zone, and it's not possible to determine with certainty where within the zone groups or individuals who wish to participate in anti-abortion activity may choose to stand. It's therefore not possible to guarantee that signs will be visible at every point where activity might take place. And where signs are noticed, they may create a gathering point behind which anti-abortion groups could safely stand, exactly on the cusp of the safe access zone. This would not be illegal, of course, but it's not something we'd seek to encourage. I therefore join with the Minister in urging the Member not to press the amendment this time and to work with me ahead of Stage 3 if she feels there's further work to do to ensure zones are sufficiently publicised.
Megan Gallagher, to wind up, place or withdraw the amendment.
Thank you, Convener, and I've listened carefully to all the points that have been raised this morning, and I'm sure my colleague Tess White and I would be happy to work with both Gillian Mackay and the Minister on this one. It's a really important issue, I think, and again, take into consideration we don't want women to feel harassed, we don't want a future gathering point for protest groups to gather outside of these premises. But I think as well, you know, just again in terms of the legalities issues that Dr Sandesh Gilhani raised, I think there is just a little bit more teasing out that we need to do ahead of stage three, but I welcome that opportunity, Convener, and for that reason I won't press.
So Megan Gallagher seeks to withdraw amendment 51. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? Okay. Call Amendment 17 in the name of Sandesh Gilhani, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Sandesh Gilhani to move Amendment 17 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. The current wording of Sections 4 and 5 mean that an offence occurs not only where a person has intention to influence, prevent access or cause harassment, but beyond that, where a person is reckless. This means that not only should people not attempt to protest abortion services, they also require to be actively vigilant beyond their normal everyday considerations to ensure that actions do not have this implication. It's my position that this is an unduly onerous burden upon the general public, and if I may give an example. Say a family is leaving the Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Glasgow and they've been told their grandfather is about to die in hospital. It is not unreasonable for them to stop within the grounds or just outside, pray or silently contemplate what they've just been told. And this might become covered by the bill if people walking past, women walking past, feel that that is praying in an activity in a way to intimidate. And we also heard in committee that police said they are not the thought police, and nor will they ever ask what somebody was thinking. So my amendments required that an effect be objectively reasonably foreseeable. In other words, there should be an offence where it is not reasonably foreseeable that an act would cause the effect. I believe my amendments avoid imposing an onerous burden upon the public while still retaining the principles of this bill. Reasonable foreseeability is a common test in Scots law. The reasonableness test appears in similar existing legislation, such as the Protection from Harassment Act. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service told the committee that guidelines issued to Police Scotland around the bill would require satisfaction of intent or recklessness beyond reasonable doubt. I am of the position that the reasonableness test should be specified in the Act for absolute clarity and for the sake of proportionality. And I move the amendments.
Thank you. Megan Gallagher to speak to Amendment 52 and the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And this amendment would, by virtue, lay out the specify the protected premises for the purposes of the offence under subsection 1. I think this is an added layer of protection to the bill in relation to any legal challenges that could be brought in future for the bill, and that is the reason for my amendment, Convener. It's very short and sweet.
Thank you. Jeremy Balfour to speak to Amendment 21 and other amendments in the group.
Excuse me. Thank you, Convener. Can I move Amendment 2 in my name? The purpose of this amendment is to exempt schools, places of worship and other such non-public places like hotels and libraries from the bill. It is to exclude what happens inside the building, not outside the building. And if I can, just take these one by one. Again, this comes from an Edinburgh context, and I'm sure it will apply to other parts of Scotland as well. So in schools, we all agree it's very important that we allow a multitude of points of view to be presented to give children a broad basis of understanding issues. If schools were included in this bill, we would be severely limiting the ability to do this. Furthermore, if a school is run by a faith-based organisation, it would preclude them from affirming any part of their doctrine that fell foul of the buffer zone. So, for example, there is, within the 200 metres within the Edinburgh context, a Roman Catholic school. Now, I'm sure we would not want to limit what happens inside the school in regard to debate, but my concern is that if the bill is passed without this amendment, then that would happen. The same is true for places of worship. As currently written, the bill would stop churches, mosques, synagogues and other holy buildings from hosting any kind of speaker or event that was different from the views on abortion. This is a clear infringement of religion. Again, can I emphasise, this is not what happens at the doorstep, it's what happens inside the building. And finally, convener, venues such as libraries and hotels often hold meetings and conferences for a wide variety of interest groups. For example, again, without Bournemouth Committee within the Edinburgh context, if my measuring is right, we would be excluding the Edinburgh Book Festival from being able to debate any issue around abortion because it is within the 200-metre range. Now, I am sure that is not what the member or the government want to do, and it would be wrong to prohibit holding such meetings if there is no intent to harm or harass anyone by simply discussing the topic. Convener, I understand the way I've drafted this is a very blunt instrument, and again, I'm using it as a probing amendment to see where Julie Mackay and the government are on. I won't preach this amendment, but I would generally look for some reassurance and seek some understanding from both the member and from the government about how we do not stop freedom of speech within these venues going forward. If I can move to Amendment 3, that is the hours of operation. Convener, again, we've discussed this previously already, and that is the balance between freedom of speech, expression and religion, and absolutely the women can access these services in a safe way. In order to maximise the former and minimise the latter, this amendment seeks to limit the effect of the law to during the hours that protected premises is operational. Now, I personally could see no reason why anyone would want to do this, but I also believe in the freedom of right to speech. So if somebody wanted to go and protest outside a building which was closed and no one was going into, then they should be allowed to do that. It seems to me a reasonable compromise that understands the strength of feeling on both sides while ensuring that the law remains as effective at stopping harassment as it would be without it. This, and I absolutely want to emphasise this on the record, is not meant to be a reckon amendment in no way at all. It's not a bad faith attempt to make the bill less effective. It is a well-intentioned effort to find a compromise that I hope gives the right of freedom of speech, at the same time allowing women to feel absolutely safe when exercising these services. If I can move on to Amendment 4, and for the record, I will be moving this amendment later on. I should also declare I am a former church minister. This amendment seeks to carve out an exception in the law for those who are carrying out chaplaincy services at protected premises. The services rendered by chaplains from all faiths cannot be underestimated. They are often meeting people at their lowest point and providing pastoral care that can be absolutely key to a patient's recovery. They are a fundamental part of hospital care, We don't just deal with a person, we deal with the spiritual as well as the physical. For this reason, it is crucial that we are free to have open, honest and frank discussions that cover a wide range of issues. It should be up to the patient to decide the content of those partial conversations, not the law. To be clear, the exception does not give licence to chaplains to pressure people into one decision or another. It does not give them the ability to set up a store or to protest. It doesn't even necessarily give them licence to bring the topic up. But it does allow them to respond to patients who are seeking guidance or a faith perspective on their care options going forward. I hope the committee will accept this amendment to ensure that women can have access to partial care that they want at the time that they want. If I can move on to section 5 of the bill. I understand that there are those that are angry with this amendment. I've been accused of the press that I'm trying to wreck the bill with it, and I've been intended as a backdoor effort to allow protesters to skirt the law. For the record, can I say there is no such thing in trying to do this. I've been painted as being in favour of these protests and endorsing the way that they go about the demonstrations. Again, for the record, even though I do think that people have the freedom to gather and demonstrate, I do not agree with sometimes the tactics of demonstrating outside clinics. I don't think it's effective or helpful, and I've never taken part in any of these events. What I do on 3 days a week is stand at a bus stop within the 200 metres of the Chalmers Clinic here in Edinburgh. I do not plan for what I'm going to pray for, but sometimes as a Christian, I do pray at that bus stop. I do not pray always for the same things, but occasionally I might want to pray around the issue of abortion. The way that this bill is currently written, and I'd be interested to know if the Minister agrees with this, this prayer would be breaking the law. I should be prosecuted. Even though there's no outward action, even though only myself and God know what I'm thinking, I would legally be breaking the law. Even if we put aside the possibility of how do you enforce this, do we really, as a parliament, want to be in the business of policing thought in this way? Do we really want to infringe on religious freedom in this way? This amendment does not allow for groups to plan and gather in safe access zones. It does not allow people to organise a rolling vigil. What it does, it seeks to protect individual, silent meditation and prayer. And I do urge the government, if they aren't willing to support this today, to give some kind of clarification as to where the law is. Finally, you'll be glad to hear, Convener, I would move Amendment 25. This follows on from what my colleague has said already this morning. It includes the defence of reasonableness to the bill, exactly the same way that appears in the Hate Crime Scotland Act. It would help to protect freedom and ensure that the law is not overly harshly applied. Again, I think it's really important what the Minister said early on in the debate, is that we are future-proofing this bill, not just for today, tomorrow, 5 years, but for decades to go. And I hope this can achieve broad support. After all, no one is suggesting that reasonable behaviour should be prosecuted, and this amendment guarantees this will not be an issue. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And going forward, it would be helpful if members refer to the amendments as they are rather than their own amendment numbers. Thank you. Just for so members can keep up with what's being debated. Rachel Hamilton to speak to Amendment 56 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 56 makes it a prohibited behaviour to film a person who is within the designated safe zone access, alongside outlining penalties for such a breach. This is a focused amendment that comes into effect if a person is prevented, impeded or harassed in gaining access to abortion services within the buffer zone, or their decision is influenced by filming within this area. It is worth noting And I share with the committee that this amendment is similar to a provision in the Northern Ireland Safe Access Zone Bill, which prevents intimidation or harassment of a person through filming within the Safe Access Zone. Furthermore, I bring members' attention to the nuance between my amendment and Amendment 57 in the name of my colleague Megan Gallagher, which makes it an offence to record a person in a Safe Access Zone. My specific amendment focuses on the effect of filming rather than the act itself. And as outlined in my amendment, effects include influencing, preventing or impeding another person to access, provide or facilitate the provision of abortion services. And in addition to causing harassment, alarm or distress to another person who is accessing or providing abortion services. And I see both amendments as important. And I look forward to hearing the Minister's view.
Thank you. Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. I'm going to speak to some of the amendments. This was a section that the committee took lots of evidence on, and I think on balance, it was important that we did so, and that Scottish Labour have considered all of these points and want to try and get that balance of human rights correct. So we do really support the debate that is happening this morning. The particular amendments I'm going to mention is Amendments 17, 18 and 20 in the name of Sandesh Gulhani. We felt they were not obviously necessary and a bit unclear. I do appreciate the debate this morning from the member, which has been very helpful in clarifying what your intention was with the amendments. We are not going to support those particular amendments. In terms of the amendments in the name of the member Jeremy Balfour, I really appreciate your contribution this morning, because we have considered all of these points. In terms of 21, we are glad to see that is a probing amendment. That was helpful that you clarified that particular point. In terms of Amendment 22, we have considered this again and again, because I think you're absolutely right that we need to get this particular one right. We had hoped that you perhaps would consider working with the government as we go towards stage three.
Can the member just take a quick
note? Of course.
I am always into cross-party cooperation, and if the Minister or Julie Mackay is happy to work with her, I would certainly be open to that suggestion.
Okay, that's very helpful, thank you. And certainly it's something that Scottish Labour would be prepared to speak with you about as we go into stage three as well. In terms of 23, we would not be supporting this amendment. We believe that the flexibility is required, because we're not always sure in healthcare exactly what the times of opening and closing, when people may be coming out of these services. We think that would be restrictive, so we wouldn't want to have that particular amendment included. And in terms of 24, we believe the bill and the way that it's set out, not mentioning behaviours, is the best way to approach this particular bill, and so we would not be supporting that amendment today. If I could also mention 56 and 57, I really appreciate the members' contributions on filming, because we are very sympathetic to this. Have I got the right amendments there? It's the ones from Rachel Hamilton and Megan Gallagher, on filming. We absolutely understand the motives for adding these in. We do have some concerns that this falls into the area of recording or placing in the bill behaviours. So at this stage, we would hope that it would be something that we could look at to work together towards stage three. So we're not going to support it. We're going to consider it, but not support it at this stage. And that is me. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. Megan Gallagher.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm grateful for your time and allowing me back in. It's just to reflect on Amendments 56 and 57 and the name of my colleague Rachel Hamilton and myself, because these are what I think, you know, important amendments. Again, it's about deterrent, it's about prevention, and it's about adding in additional layers of protection for vulnerable women who are seeking to access these healthcare services. If I may pick up on the slight differences between our two amendments, and I think they are good to be different in this respect, because it brings in the element of filming but also the element of recording as well. And the reason for bringing these amendments forward is because, you know, there could be in future, given the consistent evolution of social media, different ways in which women could find themselves being harassed by certain groups. They could end up finding themselves online, they could end up finding images of themselves accessing these services, because groups are no longer able to stand out with the healthcare clinics themselves. So I think this is certainly the reason for myself bringing forward this amendment, is to add that additional layer of protection. If the opportunity is open, I would be grateful to work with anyone who is looking to seek to add in additional layers of protection for vulnerable women, and I would be grateful for the Minister's comments on this particular element, because I do believe that Rachel Hamilton's amendment and my amendment would bring an important additional element to this legislation. Thank you.
Minister.
Thank you, Convener. This is a complex topic and my remarks are accordingly quite lengthy. However, I will, before addressing any specifics, note that the provisions in this group would almost universally be highly damaging to the intent and practical operation of the bill. The exception, in my view, is Mr Balfour's Amendment 22, which would create a specific exemption from the offences under the bill relating to the provision of chaplaincy services. The government would like more time to consider that, to ensure it would apply equally to all faiths, but we do not object in principle to the idea. I hope Mr Balfour will not press his amendment to allow that to happen. And I must ask that the committee resists all amendments if Mr Balfour does press, but he's indicating he might not. I will first turn to Dr Gulhani's Amendments 17 to 20, which seek to introduce an exception to the Sections 4 and 5 offences where the effects of an action are not reasonably foreseeable. I am grateful for Dr Gulhani's thoughtful and considered questioning during committee scrutiny, and I know his amendments are intended to increase safeguards within the bill. However, I must ask members to vote against the amendments on the grounds that the amendments would undermine a key element of the bill while failing to strengthen it in a meaningful way. A key purpose of this bill is to ensure that women and staff are not required to come forward to report their experiences of anti-abortion activity to the police in order for an offence to be committed and protections to apply. For understandable reasons, given the personal and sometimes upsetting nature of the matters concerned, women and staff are often reluctant to do this. Moreover, requiring women to report harm they have experienced means that harm must happen before action can be taken. That is entirely opposite to the aim of this bill, which is, as far as possible, to prevent certain harmful effects in the first place. The offences would be committed in two scenarios: where acts are carried out with the intention of influencing, impeding, causing alarm or harassment, or where acts are carried out recklessly as to whether they have those effects. In either case, whether an offence has been committed will be based on the evidence of the behaviour of the individual, either to assess their intentions or to establish if they were reckless as to their effects. The result is that an actual demonstrable effect on a specific person does not require to be evidenced, and crucially, women or staff do not need to come forward and make a report before action can be taken. Instead, other witnesses can report the behaviour and provide corroborating evidence. The amendment would provide that even if a person carried out an act with the intention of causing one of the effects in the offence provisions, it would not amount to an offence unless the foreseeability test were met. That creates uncertainty around the offence provisions and their enforcement without any discernible benefit. In practical terms, it's hard to conceive of a situation where intention to influence or harass or intimidate an individual could be established without it being reasonably foreseeable that the act in question would have that effect. In relation to the recklessness offence, there must be evidence that the accused had an utter disregard as to its effects. There must be a very high degree of indifference as to the consequences of the actions. Recklessness will generally be inferred from all the circumstances of the case and will involve to some extent the court considering the likely consequences of the accused's action. To that extent, whether the consequence was reasonably foreseeable or should have been reasonably foreseeable will be something the court may consider. I therefore must reiterate that these amendments weaken the bill without benefit. I urge members to preserve the original intent of the bill and vote against Amendments 17 to 20. Similarly, I do not support Mr Balfour's Amendment 25 in the strongest terms. It runs directly counter to the bill's aims, as it allows for behaviour, despite meeting the high threshold for the offence provisions, to be considered reasonable and constitute a defence. This runs the risk that the potential protection provided by the bill would be significantly diminished. In very simple terms, the amendment would mean that someone charged with an offence under this bill may raise a defence that the act was reasonable. A person could admit they had intended to influence someone accessing services, but to also claim, for example, that they did not know they were in a safe access zone, no matter how extensive the publicity around it was. They could claim it was a weekend and they thought premises would be closed. They could claim the strength of their belief or their own particular circumstances justified the offence. They could state that they had intended to provide support for women accessing the services and were justified on this basis. To be clear, it will always be possible for an accused to make these arguments. It is, of course, their right to produce mitigating evidence in their favour and show they neither intended to have that effect or were reckless as to the consequences of their actions. But this defence would build in potential loopholes from the outset. This argument has been made several times today, but I must do so again. No other safe access zones legislation across the UK includes such a defence. In Northern Ireland, it was considered during parliamentary passage and rejected for the reasons I've just outlined. And it was precisely the absence of such a defence that the Supreme Court was asked to rule on when it considered the legislation. The court held that the offences provided for within the bill, which are broadly similar to those we are considering here, constituted a proportionate interference with the rights of anti-abortion groups in light of the importance of the bill's aims. And crucially, the Supreme Court considered that the inclusion of a reasonable excuse defence would impact the effectiveness of its provisions to achieve that aim. It is the government's view that similar considerations apply in respect of this bill. There is a risk that the defence could be used to justify behaviours which would otherwise be caught and which therefore have the precise impacts on women and staff accessing services we are seeking to prevent. I therefore ask you to resist Amendment 25. Amendments 56 and 57 on filming and photography offences. I will address both amendments in general terms. This matter was considered during bill development and it was concluded that the offences as drafted would capture photography or filming. As I've said throughout this session, the offences have deliberately been broadly drafted to avoid criminalising specific behaviours, but rather to capture any activity that could have the effects outlined in sections 4 and 5. Therefore, if someone was filming or photographing a person accessing or providing services either recklessly or with the intent of influencing, impeding access or causing alarm, that would very likely be caught up by the existing provisions. I do not think it's difficult to understand why, as we keep repeating, the issue at the heart of this bill is that women are accessing medical care and making extremely personal decisions. In these circumstances, photography or filming done with the intent or recklessness would be very likely to have one of the effects set out in the offence provisions. It is not normal practice to provide for an offence where there is an existing offence that would adequately cover the relevant behaviour. In this case, the offence of filming or photography is already caught by the offences we are creating in this bill. I'll give way.
Thank you to the Minister for giving way. It's just on the point where you said likely. That's obviously a risk because there would be some exceptions then where it might not fall into what would be deemed an offence within that section of the bill. So I'm just wondering, has the Minister carried out any further work on that to see what the parameters would be for breaching that or managing to get away with that particular offence?
I'll continue, and I think my responses will answer Ms Gallagher's point. I must impress upon the committee that the offences have been drafted to avoid setting out a list of prohibited behaviours. It is the effect that matters. That is essential to ensure this bill remains future-proofed. We must avoid doing anything that would significantly undercut that approach. Otherwise, the very situation we've worked so hard to prevent may arise, that we introduce doubt by covering one activity and not others. I will.
And thank you to the Minister for taking the intervention. It has been noted in research that the degree of emotional distress is not proportionate to the act of filming, and therefore to make it explicit in the bill, I think, is really important, because if you're looking at a broad brush around offences that may cover this, and you did, and I highlight what Megan Gallagher said, that it would be very likely, I quote to you, very likely to be covered in this, but it's also important that any act that disproportionately impacts on the privacy of women and even defers them to seek other treatments or defers the time that they seek the treatment, I think that this, both of these amendments should be considered in the round of the selective approach to an activity that should be prohibited specifically. And I would really be grateful if you could work with us on this.
I thank Ms Hamilton and Ms Gallagher for their offers. And I think in Ms Gallagher's second contribution, you talked about the crossover and in some respects the separation between your two amendments. I am content to meet with both of you further to discuss this if you agree not to press. Convener, apologies, I've already spoken for some time, and I'll therefore note that I'm aware that Ms Mackay intends to speak to a number of other amendments and will limit myself to briefly setting out the Government's position on these. Amendment 23 is unnecessary because of the way the bill is drafted. The person carrying out anti-abortion activity capable of being caught by the bill must already be in the zone at the same time as another person trying to access or provide services, unless the Act has a continuing effect, and it would be unworkable in practice. Amendment 24 is both unnecessary and would weaken the protections the bill is providing. Silent prayer is not itself an offence under the current provisions and thus does not need to be exempted. Moreover, doing so could allow conduct that has been shown to have the negative impacts this bill seeks to prevent and could create loopholes that could exempt other behaviour beyond silent prayer. Finally, amendments 21 and 52 to 55. With regards to amendment 21, if I may just add a point of clarification, the safe access zone does not include indoor spaces, not schools or places of worship. So I hope that gives Mr Balfour some clarity. These amendments 21, 52 to 55 would cut across one of the key aims of the bill, the need to take a preventative approach. Amendment 21 would remove Section 5 entirely, whilst amendments 52 to 55 would require regulations to be laid and approved before women and staff could be guaranteed protection within a zone. Until those regulations were passed, conduct which is both intended to be public and to have particular harmful effects could be carried on. And in the case of Mr Balfour's amendment 21, there would be no scope to prevent that. In conclusion, I urge members not to support the amendments in this group.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. As the Minister noted, there's a significant amount to cover in this group, and in the interest of maintaining momentum, I'll also not repeat what the Minister has already said, but will apologise for the length of my comments that I'm about to make. I'll use my time to cover amendments 24, 21, 22, 23, and we'll touch on the amendments around photography as well in summing up. Amendment 24 on silent prayer. I've listened carefully to the arguments for an exemption since the bill was introduced, and I hope members will believe that I've thought long and hard about them. That's because, as I've said from the outset, I recognise the importance prayer can play in the lives of people of faith. I've never sought to minimise or undermine that, and I do not believe this bill does either. On the other hand, having considered the matter, I am convinced that an exemption for silent prayer would undermine the bill and what it's seeking to do. I urge members to vote against the amendment on two grounds. Firstly, that it's unnecessary, and secondly, it would fundamentally weaken the protection that the bill seeks to provide women and staff. On the first point, as I highlighted during the Stage 1 debate, the bill does not prohibit specific behaviours in a safe access zone. Silent prayer is therefore not in of itself prohibited. In particular reference to Mr Balfour's example, he would not be breaking the law in quiet personal reflection. Put another way, the offences are not about what you're thinking, but what you're doing and the effect that has on others. When Police Scotland gave evidence at Stage 1, they said they were not going to police what people were thinking, and I wholly support that. This amendment, on the other hand, would require enforcement agencies to try to do exactly that, and I hope some illustrations will help here. If someone prays silently without outward sign on their way to the hospital, or even does so outside the hospital or in a bus stop, to use Mr Balfour's example, for a few minutes, it's very unlikely that anyone would be aware that they are silently praying. If nobody knows someone's praying and nothing in their conduct is capable of having the effects on women or staff that this bill seeks to prevent, then it is unlikely that any offence could be committed. But if someone stands silently praying for a long time, deliberately looking at women accessing an abortion clinic, or, for example, with a sign, as we see at the moment, then they may be committing an offence. But it's not because of the prayer. It's because of the sense of judgment. It's about the effects of this conduct, positioning themselves in that location on women and staff accessing the clinic. And an offence would only be committed where the full facts and circumstances demonstrated the behaviour was intended to have those effects, or was reckless as to whether it did. And this is why an exemption is unnecessary. But as I said at the start, not only is the exemption unnecessary, it is damaging. Setting silent prayer itself aside, the amendment could have the unintended consequence of creating loopholes for other conduct. As I mentioned earlier, someone could simply stand for hours looking at women and staff monitoring their comes and goings, and this exemption could provide cover. That in itself might be enough to reject this amendment. But even setting that aside, conduct that gives rise to the harmful effects on women and staff that this bill seeks to prevent should not be permitted simply because someone is silently praying at the time. I understand that there are those who do not think that silent prayer could have any of the effects prohibited in the bill. I must remind members at this point that we've heard evidence from women and staff that they feel intimidated and judged when they try to access or provide healthcare services and encounter people praying outside. I know it's obvious, but I must emphasise this point. It is people positioning themselves outside these services. It's probably happening right now when people are accessing medical care to which they're entitled, when they're making personal decisions, and when many of them will already be feeling vulnerable or afraid. In those circumstances, they are, as what I've referred to already, as a captive audience. They have no way of escaping the presence of those praying. They cannot simply go to another venue or come back another day. In contrast, as Ross Greer pointed out during the Stage 1 debate, those who oppose abortion can pray anywhere else, including just up the road. What we're talking about here is a very narrow restriction that will have the profound impact of affording women and staff dignity, privacy and respect when they need it the most. I'd also remind committee that we are not the only body to consider this matter, and that others before us have accepted that silent presence can have a negative impact. The Supreme Court noted in their consideration of the Northern Ireland legislation that silent but reproachful observance of people accessing an abortion clinic may be as effective as a means of deterring them from getting an abortion as more boisterous demonstrations. And in Livia Toskey-Bolt versus Bournemouth, Christchurch and Poole Council, which considered a public space protection order creating a safe access zone around an abortion clinic, the court commented that, and I quote, "The protest activities described in the evidence, including silent prayer, were not taking place in a shopping centre or park or in a church, but outside a clinic to which women were resorting at particularly sensitive and difficult moments in their lives. Those activities were quite reasonably interpreted as an expression of opposition or disapproval." I hope Indeed, I trust that in this room the testimonies of women and staff, including those provided through evidence to this committee, will be given the same weight as they were in those cases. And once we accept that silent prayer can be harmful, we must also accept that exempting it fails to deliver adequate protection. It certainly would not provide the level of protection promised across the rest of the UK. An exemption for silent prayer was proposed as an amendment to the Public Order Act, and it was rejected. Likewise, there's no exemption in the legislation in force in Northern Ireland. There's no way around this reality. If we accept Amendment 24 today, we'll be saying we're comfortable leaving women and staff in Scotland more vulnerable than their counterparts across the UK. I urge members of the committee to prevent that from happening. Instead, vote against this amendment and ensure that women and staff in Scotland receive the protection promised by this bill as introduced. I'll now turn to the amendments from Mr Balfour and Ms Gallagher to Section 5 of the bill. I'm grateful for the challenge this section has received. It's right that it should be scrutinised carefully given its potential impact. However, as I set out to committee during Stage 1, the impact of the provision is carefully limited, and it's vital to ensure the protection we are providing is robust. Before I turn to the particular amendments, I'll first clarify the purpose and scope of Section 5. Contrary to some misunderstandings I've seen, this section does not extend a safe access zone indefinitely. Section 5 applies only to areas inside the 200-metre boundary of the zone. Out with that boundary, people are free to conduct any lawful anti-abortion activity in any location they choose. I must also impress upon members that even within the zone, wholly private actions will not be subject to sanction. Private conversations in homes and in restaurants, religious lessons in schools and sermons and hymns within a church would be unlikely to meet the conditions for an offence set out in Section 5. Instead, an offence would likely be committed where either an activity or behaviour is deliberately done in an outward-facing public way for the purpose of influencing, impeding access or alarming someone trying to access or provide services, or an activity is done with an utter disregard as to whether it could have those consequences or a high level of indifference to those consequences. Crucially, where the activity or behaviour constitutes an offence under Section 5 will be operational decisions for enforcement agencies, and Police Scotland have already explained to committee how they would approach enforcement. This, combined with the targeted scope of the provisions, I hope provides committee some reassurance. However, I do recognise that this impacts on rights, and I understand why it, at first sight, may cause members more concern than the offences created by Section 4. The provisions have been considered carefully and have been included only because they are necessary. Mr Balfour's amendment, which would remove the section entirely, would result in a significant loophole that would allow anti-abortion activities to take place within a safe access zone. It's clear from the evidence committee has heard, from example from Colin Pullman, provided a hypothetical example of an organisation setting up their headquarters within a zone and then using that building to conduct anti-abortion activity designed to target women and staff. Colin Pullman commented that that would defeat the purposes of the bill. If Section 5 were to be removed from the bill, this hypothetical example could take place. That may seem an unlikely threat, except the committee also heard from Professor Sharon Cameron, who explained that we already have examples of anti-choice messages being projected onto Charmish Sexual Health Centre from a property across the street. Without Section 5, there'll be nothing to protect against that kind of activity carried out in private places within the zone. Ms Gallagher and Amendments 52 to 55 does still provide for the possibility of that protection, and I thank her for recognising that it's important. However, the effect of her amendment in practice would still be to diminish the bill. As I've said throughout this process, a key aim of the bill is to prevent harm. But these amendments would, at the very least, mean that on day one, public-facing activity of the kind I've already described would be possible in safe access zones until such times Parliament passed regulations. Yes.
Thank you for taking the amendment. If I can just go back, as I said, I totally accept that my amendment is not the right way forward. But would she recognise and be willing to have further discussions around simply making sure that what happens in a room in a school or in a room in a hotel or in a church building with the doors closed is not caught unintentionally by this? Now, I appreciate what the Minister said, in her view, it's not, but I think there is still some concern amongst the faith community that this may happen unintentionally. So would she be willing to have a further conversation around that before the stage three bill?
More than happy to have a conversation with Mr. Balfour to see how we can allay any more of those concerns, particularly for those faith-based communities that may be within safe access zones. Before I conclude, I want to make a couple of other points. First, that limiting public-facing activity or behaviour is not unique to this bill. There are already circumstances where actions in private places can constitute a breach of the peace. As with this bill, that's because the circumstances justify the restrictions. The Public Order Act 2023 provides that a safe access zone includes any location visible from public spaces or from the curtilage of an abortion clinic. Draft Home Office guidance on safe access zones under the Public Order Act 2023 read as follows. A sermon about abortion inside a church within a safe access zone which does not affect persons outside who are accessing, providing or facilitating services would not be unlawful. However, if people lean out of the windows or stand on the driveways and call out comments to passers-by about abortion, they could commit an offence. I ask the committee to vote against these amendments if they are pressed to ensure that we have parity for women and staff here in Scotland with the rest of the UK. Mr. Balfour's Amendment 23 would create an exception to offences where behaviour was carried out while premises were closed. I must urge committee to reject this amendment on grounds that it would lessen protection for patients and staff while adding significant complexity in administration. As I've noted already, the offence requires that actions are carried out with either the intention of having the effects set out in sections 4 and 5, or where the individual is reckless as to whether those effects occur. The person carrying out the activity must be in the zone, and that they must be intending to influence someone who's also in the zone at the time, unless the act in question has a continuing effect. Therefore, if behaviours take place and premises are closed, and no one could be said to be on their way to access or provide services, the actions are unlikely to be an offence unless, as I've said, they have a continuing effect. I'll take Mr. Gulhani first.
Thank you. We have to also remember, though, that there are staff who could feel upset when they are attending work when the clinic is closed.
Mr. Gulhani is preempting the second part of my comments on that amendment, and I do agree that we don't know. There are many different shift patterns within many of the hospitals that that the bill would cover, and there is no way generally to know when those staff are coming and going, so protection for those staff is essential. I'll take Mr. Balfour's intervention as well.
I'm grateful for the convener. Hypothetically, a clinic is open between 9 and 5, Monday to Friday. On a Saturday afternoon, if the clinic was closed, in her opinion, would it be legal to have a demonstration outside that clinic if there was no staff going in or out and it was simply a Saturday afternoon or 2 o'clock in the morning?
Mr. Balfour will understand that I'm a marine biologist, not a lawyer. So my opinion on whether that would be lawful or not is potentially unhelpful in this sense. I think I've laid out in my comments previously that the continuing effect is something that has to be taken into consideration. Some of the protests we've seen have had the impact on staff of being concerned to come to their work, on patients of being concerned to attend appointments the following day. We've seen activity outside of Sandyford over weekends that have, anecdotally from staff, caused people to either delay treatment or to cancel and rearrange appointments. And I think Dr. Gulhani's points about the fact that services could be closed to patients but staff members could still be on the premises to carry out non-clinical duties that are nonetheless vital for the facilitation and provision of services. And I believe the current provision provides operational flexibility for enforcement agencies to consider the full facts of the case before deciding if an offence has been committed. A definitive exception would mean staff working on the premises when they're closed to the public would have no protection. Secondly, the scenario that Mr. Balfour says about a clinic ordinarily running from 9 to 5 Monday to Friday, on a particular weekend, anti-abortion groups could organise a protest. But on that particular weekend, and unbeknown to the groups, the premises has extended its opening hours to allow staff to see patients and clear waiting lists. criminal sanctions do apply, and those attending the services are potentially exposed to exactly the behaviours the bill intends to stop before the situation can be communicated to the anti-abortion groups and the activity ceases. That is a real scenario that could happen if we pass this amendment, and they are surely scenarios that none of us want to see. The only way a situation could potentially be avoided would be for each protected premises to advertise its opening hours, including any changes. And that's an additional administrative burden on staff, and it potentially draws attention to exactly when patients and staff can be targeted. And it still does not satisfy the situation when services are closed to the patients but staff are still in attendance. The result is a system that reduces protection and vastly increases the difficulty of communicating and understanding when zones apply. It's unfair both for staff and patients and for those who may be subject to criminal sanctions, and I therefore urge committee members to vote against the amendment. Amendments 56 and 57, I'm grateful to both Rachel Hamilton and Megan Gallagher for their conversations around these provisions. I'm still of the view that listing individual behaviours is something we may not want to do, and I believe that these offences are implicitly covered in the bill. I'm grateful for the opportunity to discuss and highlight that these are covered by the bill and that they are not acceptable outside settings. I recognise the intent from both Rachel Hamilton and Megan Gallagher is to make the bill better. However, I believe that beginning to list behaviours runs contrary to the work we've done this far, but I am happy to have further conversations like the Minister ahead of stage three. Yes.
Just on filming, and I'm glad that the Minister and Gillian will both be willing to discuss this, it is potentially even more intimidating than a protest to be filmed walking into somewhere and that being put on social media. And with the quality of cameras and the quality of filming, it can be done from a very large distance away or even potentially a property. So though we wouldn't want to have every single potential reason listed, having an example or one thing which is, I think, particularly intimidating, harassing, is quite important.
And I appreciate that that intervention from Dr. Gulhani. The problem I have is that there are various people who have given me evidence of their particular situation, where you could cover just about every behaviour that happens outside clinics, and they believe that's the most intimidatory thing that could happen. So that's where, for me, singling out particular behaviours becomes difficult when different people who have experienced these protests would place different weight on different behaviours. I absolutely agree that recording and then the sharing of people's images that we have seen at Sandyford with one particular staff member can be particularly damaging for those staff. And I'd be, if Dr. Gulhani has a particular interest as well, very, very happy to open up a wider discussion amongst more members if people are interested on filming and photography in particular, in addition to the conversation that the Minister and I will have with Rachel Hamilton and Megan Gallagher. Finally, turning to Amendment 22, and I will finish in a minute, Convener, I promise. As I noted in my evidence committee, I think it's unlikely the activities of chaplains or spiritual advisers would be caught by the bill. In general, the role of hospital chaplains is to listen and support those considering an abortion rather than providing advice. Such support is not considered to be intended to influence decisions. It will have been requested by the women rather than it being an unwanted conversation. As such, these circumstances would not appear likely to result in an offence. However, I recognise that the bill contains a specific exemption for healthcare and that there are parallels with chaplaincy care. I should also note that we have received a request from the Royal College of Nursing to look at that exemption for healthcare staff, and we are looking at that. There were logistical issues with the timing of that request for stage two. Women choose to speak to healthcare professionals and may be persuaded to have or not have an abortion based on the advice they are given, even if the advice is not intended to persuade the women one way or another. I also recognise the concern about women being dissuaded from seeking chaplaincy or spiritual support, so I'm happy to put the matter beyond doubt. However, it is important that this applies to all faiths, therefore I will consider whether a further amendment may be needed at stage three to make this clear. I therefore would urge Mr Balfour not to press his amendment and to work with me to explore bringing forward an amendment at stage three. And if Mr Balfour presses his amendment, I ask members to vote against it. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Gillian Mackay. Sandish Gohani to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 17.
Thank you, Convener. Given what the Minister said about there being a high degree regarding recklessness, I feel that I will withdraw 17 and 18 and 19. But
thank you, Mr Gohani. Sandish Gohani seeks to withdraw Amendment 17. Does any member object? No one objects. Sandish Gohani seeks to withdraw Amendment 18. Does any member object? The question is that Section 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. And I'm going to suspend proceedings for 10 minutes for a comfort break. Yep. Thanks. I call Amendment 52 in the name of Megan Gallagher, already debated with Amendment 17. Megan Gallagher, to move or not move?
On this occasion, Convener, I think I will move. Thank you.
Thank you.
No, 52.
Are the committee agreed? Okay. Committee is not agreed and there will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 52, please raise your hands. Those against? Abstentions? The result of the vote on Amendment 52 is 4, 2, against 7, and there were no abstentions. Therefore, the amendment is disagreed to. I call Amendment 19 in the name of Sandesh Gohani, already debated with Amendment 17. Sandesh Gohani, to move or not move? Sandesh Gohani seeks to withdraw Amendment 19. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? Thank you. I call Amendment 53 in the name of Megan Gallagher, already debated with Amendment 17. Megan Gallagher, to move or not move?
Given 52 was not approved, Convener, I will not be moving 53.
Megan Gallagher seeks to withdraw Amendment 53. Does any member object? We should just not move. Okay. Call Amendment 20 in the name of Sandesh Gohani, already debated with Amendment 17. Sandesh Gohani, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 54 in the name of Megan Gallagher, already debated with Amendment 17. Megan Gallagher, to move or not move?
Similar to 53, I will not be moving 54, Convener.
Thank you. I call Amendment 55 in the name of Megan Gallagher, already debated with Amendment 17. Megan Gallagher, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. I call Amendment 21 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 17. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Not move, Convener, please.
Thank you. The question is that Section 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 56 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 17. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Not move, Convener.
I call Amendment 57 in the name of Megan Gallagher, already debated with Amendment 17. Megan Gallagher, to move or not move?
Not move, Convener.
Thank you. I call Amendment 22 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 17. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Can I thank the Government and the Convener for their remarks, and I won't be moving, so not moving.
I call Amendment 23 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 17. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Not move.
Call Amendment 24 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 17. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Not move.
Thank you. The question is that Section 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendments 26, 27, 28, 29 and 30, all in the name of the Minister and all previously... apologies. Amendment 25 in the name of Jeremy Balfour.
Not move, Convener.
Thank you. Call on amendments 26, 27, 28, 29 and 30, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Minister to move amendments 26 to 30 on block. Does any member object to a single question being put?
I need to ask the Minister to move.
I invite the Minister to move those amendments on block.
Moved, Convener.
Does any member have an objection to a single question being put to amendments 26 to 30 being put as a single question?
No.
The question is that amendments 26 to 30 are agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call amendment 31 in the name of Gillian Mackay, grouped with amendments 1, 2, 33, 3, 4, 5 and 34. Gillian Mackay to move amendment 31 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thanks, Convener, and I move Amendment 31. I think there's little to be said on my Amendments 31 and 33 that I did not say when I committed to introducing a consultation requirement at the Stage 1 debate. As I said then, I followed precedent when the bill was introduced by not including such a requirement on the grounds that consultation would follow a standard practice if there was any consideration of extending or reducing the size of a safe access zone. However, in recognition of the particular complexities and sensitivities surrounding this bill, I have introduced these amendments. The amendments are straightforward. Together, they provide that when the Scottish ministers are deciding of their own accord to extend or reduce the size of a zone, ministers must consult operators or persons representing their interests, as well as any other persons they consider appropriate. Where the extension follows a request from an operator, the consultation still applies to any other persons considered appropriate. I believe this satisfies the calls in the committee's Stage 1 report and hope demonstrates my commitment to strengthening the bill in response to your scrutiny wherever possible. And in recognition of the strength of feeling around the use of reduction powers, I've gone further by putting forward Amendment 34, which requires ministers to lay a report before the Parliament within 7 days of publicising a change to the size of safe access zones. In that report, they must provide their reasons for making such a change. As I will set out shortly, I think this strikes a better balance than Mr. Cole Hamilton's amendments, which I will turn to now. As a point of process, before I address the substance, I must note that amendments 2 and 4, if passed on their own, would entirely remove the powers to extend or reduce a zone. I know and have always valued Mr. Cole Hamilton's support for this bill, and I do not think this was his intent when lodging these amendments. Amendments 1 and 3 by themselves would amend the relevant sections in the way I believe he wishes. I therefore hope he will not press the other two. Taken together, Amendments 1 and 3 mean that any extension or reduction would require to be made by regulation subject to approval by the Parliament, while Amendment 5 would require ministers to set minimum and maximum zones by regulations, also subject to the affirmative procedure. As I noted in my Stage 1 response, I understand entirely the motivation behind these amendments and the understandable concern that Parliament should not be excluded from the process of changing zone sizes. Nonetheless, I will reiterate my reasons for why I believe committee should not support the amendments put forward by Mr. Cole Hamilton. The reasons for having these powers are well understood by now, so I'll only briefly highlight why they are so important. We do not know how services will operate in the future or how anti-abortion groups might choose to express their opposition outside these services. We must be able to extend zones if evidence tells us what we have is no longer effective in meeting the bill's aims, or to reduce them if the evidence tells us the level of protection we currently have goes too far. The powers in the bill today provide that flexibility. But crucially, as drafted, they ensure ministers can act quickly, something we've heard that those campaigning for the bill support. As I've explained before, where a reduction is needed, this must be done without delay, because to do so otherwise would mean individuals were subject to criminal sanction when it's unnecessary, and this would breach their convention rights. Equally, where ministers have evidence that one or more zones is not offering enough protection, they must act quickly to ensure that women do not have to wait for their rights to be protected. I am a full advocate for the Parliament having its role. I believe in it as a democratic principle, and also because I, like all members, want to ensure I can hold ministers to account. Yes, absolutely.
So my previous amendment, obviously on the measuring of the distance in the zone, you're sort of saying that in the future you will take advice if you do need to extend the zones. From the protected premises or those persons who are considered who have an interest in this. But in the past, when you had considered the 200 metres from 150, had you consulted those who would be captured in that up to the 200 metres, or is this... So it's something for the future rather than it was for the past?
So we've had ongoing dialogue with everyone impacted by safe access zones, and I understand Rachel Hamilton's interest on that difference and where it came from between the 150 metres and the 200 metres and how that interacts with the ability to extend. One of the things we heard very strongly from people was that they wanted a consistent distance across all sites, at least to begin with. There may be behaviours that means we do have to extend at different places, and there may be things that mean sometime in the future, and things I can't predict, that a reduction may be appropriate at certain sites. I think ongoing engagement once the bill is passed as well to understand those impacts and the potential impacts if an extension is to be made. And I'm sure there'll be a great deal of scrutiny around the first time that a zone has to be extended or reduced. And again, very much welcome Parliament's scrutiny on that. I think ongoing dialogue and engagement is important, and I hope that's answered what Rachel Hamilton was looking for. To go back to the amendment at hand, convener, with I am a great advocate of the democratic accountability of this Parliament, but with the best will in the world, I cannot sit here as a member of this Parliament and say we could. And guarantee, that we could act quickly if affirmative regulations are required. Even in normal times, affirmative regulations could introduce a delay of many weeks, but once recess is factored in, there may be occasions where that could stretch to months. That's months where people could be prevented or even charged with offences for expressing opposition to abortion in places where a zone is no longer needed, or months where women are subject to exactly the kinds of behaviour we agreed at stage one are intolerable. Similar concerns apply to Amendment 5. As I outlined, we do not know what changes lie ahead and therefore what size of zones will be needed. I appreciate the effort to manage this uncertainty by allowing the size of zones to be set by regulations, but again, if the evidence in early July suggests 260 metres is needed when 250 metres has been set as the maximum, or if 90 metres turns out to be sufficient when the minimum is set at 100 metres, it would be months before the change could be made. I do not think that's a solution we can be comfortable with. I must stress that the speed of change sought is only to implement changes after a rigorous process of evidence gathering has taken place. The Minister may wish to say more on this, but we must remember that the Government will always be bound to act proportionately. It's my understanding that this means they will carefully review the evidence to ensure any extension or reduction is compatible with convention rights and proportionate based on the applicable circumstances. And there is now that added safeguard that consultation will always be a vital part of the process. Therefore, any decision to extend or reduce will have been thoroughly considered and its proportionality assured. I recognise, however, that my assurance may not be sufficient. That's why I've brought forward Amendment 34, which, as I've said, requires ministers to lay a report before the Parliament within 7 days of publicising a change to the size of safe access zones, setting out their reasons for making such a change. I believe this amendment strikes the right balance. It still allows ministers to act swiftly when needed, but also ensures the Parliament has the opportunity to understand and interrogate the evidence and rationale for any change. I hope it shows I've listened to feedback and have looked for compromise, even where I've been able to go as far as all members would like. And I would ask you to trust that for as long as I'm a member of this Parliament, I will always be intensely interested in how zones are applied. I would not and could not put forward this amendment if I thought my own voice would be lost in the process. In that spirit, I ask you to vote against these amendments and ensure that the possibility to act swiftly remains while still ensuring the Parliament has its place. Thanks, Convener.
Alex Cole-Hamilton to speak to Amendment 1 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for allowing me to join you today. I'm grateful, I should say at the start, for engagement both with Gillian Mackay, MSP, and the Minister on the topics that my amendments seek to cover. We are not the first jurisdiction in the United Kingdom to bring forward legislation around safe access zones around abortion services, and both the United Kingdom Parliament and the Northern Ireland Assembly have used different legislative vehicles to bring about the effect that we're seeking to achieve here. In the UK Parliament. It was a simple amendment to another piece of legislation in the name of Stella Creasy. And again, it was a very different kind of framing of legislation in Northern Ireland, given their political context. Neither of those bills or neither of those legislative vehicles contained provision to allow ministers unfettered power to moderate or change the exclusion zones that we're talking about here. And my particular concern, and the reason for lodging these amendments, and a couple of them are more probing than anything else, is to make the point, is that we as legislators need to govern for the political consensus as it may become in the future, rather than as it is now or we would wish it to be. And my anxiety is that without having proper scrutiny from Parliament, that a less progressive administration in the future, and with ministers of that, may simply reduce the buffer zone reach to zero, the distance of that buffer zone to zero, without any recourse to Parliament, which is why I've submitted amendments 1 and 3, which are, I'll wait to hear for the minister's remarks, but I'm still intending to press. 2 and 4 is really just a reflection of, I'm not entirely sure this is needed, any reference to the expansion or reduction, because it's not doesn't seem to be needed in the other jurisdictions that I've talked about. But like I say, this is more really just to get these points on the record, to explore solutions with Gillian Mackay and with the Scottish Government. And I think I probably covered everything I need to there, Convener. I'll draw my remarks to a close.
Thank you. Carol Malkin.
Thank you, Convener. Again, I just want to briefly set out Scottish Labour's position in this section. We believe that Gillian Mackay has really engaged with right across the parties, and we are very thankful for her listening to that. And her remarks today clarify our position on the amendments that she's brought forward. In particular, Amendment 34, we believe is a good amendment to have there, and we support that as well. In relation to the amendments from Alex Cole-Hamilton, it's been very helpful to hear his contribution, because we were a bit unclear about removing the section. We did not support it at all. We thought it was unreasonable, but I think it will be useful to hear the response from the Minister, and we thank everybody for contributing to this section.
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Convener. And my thanks also to Ms Mackay for setting out so clearly her reasons for bringing forward Amendments 31, 33 and 34 and for opposing Mr Cole-Hamilton's amendments. I, like Ms Mackay, am grateful for Mr Cole-Hamilton's support on this bill. I know he has a sincere wish to ensure it offers women and staff meaningful protection, both now and in the future. Mr Cole-Hamilton's amendments today, I believe, also reflect that, and I understand his wish to ensure that the Parliament will always have oversight over how ministers use what are, I admit, significant powers. However, I fully support the arguments made by Ms Mackay. As Mr Cole-Hamilton knows only too well, As Mr Cole-Hamilton knows only too well, having lent his voice to this cause for a number of years, the work to bring the bill to fruition has not always been easy. Having worked so hard to ensure the bill offers adequate protection, and having taken the time to assure ourselves of its fair balance between competing interests, we must now ensure we can preserve both. That means having a process in place that will allow us to act without delay where the evidence tells us some or all zones are no longer fit for purpose. I will not go over the reasons why that is so important again, but I will confirm that Ms Mackay's understanding of the requirements on the government is correct. Acting compatibly with the European Convention on Human Rights is an obligation on ministers, not an optional extra or a matter of best practice, as I've said before. That means every decision using the powers in Section 7 and 8 of the bill would require the most rigorous scrutiny, considering all available evidence and taking into account the whole circumstances. That would hold true whether we were considering one zone or all zones, and whether the change was 5 metres or 50 metres. And that also means a limit on zone sizes is inherent in the process. If ministers act arbitrarily and extend a zone based on reasons that are not evidence-based, and which either infringe rights of freedom or of expression, religion or assembly more than is justifiable, or do not go far enough to protect the Article 8 rights of women and staff, they would not be acting compatibly with the Convention. If we fail in that duty, we rightly can and would be held accountable. And by putting forward Amendment 34, Ms Mackay has ensured that the Parliament, and indeed anyone else with an interest, will be able to scrutinise the degree to which we have discharged that duty. I hope members will embrace that compromise and vote to accept Amendments 31, 33 and 34, rather than compromising the bill by accepting Mr Cole Hamilton's amendments, well-intentioned though they are. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Gillian Mackay, to wind up and place or withdraw Amendment 31.
Thanks, Convener. I thank Mr Cole Hamilton for considering the extension and reduction of safe access zones in depth and for introducing his amendments. I know his genuine interest in this topic. For reasons I've already outlined, I ask Mr Cole Hamilton not to press Amendments 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5, and if he does, I ask committee members to vote against them. I hope members will recognise the layer of additional oversight that my amendments bring and will vote for them. And in the interest of time, Convener, I move Amendment 31.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, I call Amendment 47 in the name of Emma Harper, already debated with Amendment 8. Emma Harper, to move or not move?
Moved, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 47 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 1 in the name of Alex Cole-Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 31. Alex Cole-Hamilton, to move or not move?
Having listened to the remarks of both Gillian Mackay and the Minister, Convener, I will not move.
I call Amendment 2 in the name of Alex Cole-Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 31. Alex Cole-Hamilton, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. I call Amendment 32. The question is that Section 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 32 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 8. Minister, to move formally.
Moved formally.
The question is that Amendment 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 33 in the name of Gillian Mackay, already debated with Amendment 31. Gillian Mackay, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 48 in the name of Emma Harper, already debated with Amendment 8. Emma Harper, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 48 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 3 in the name of Alex Cole-Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 31. Alex Cole-Hamilton, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Call Amendment 4 in the name of Alex Cole-Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 31. Alex Cole-Hamilton, to move or not move?
Not moved.
The question is that Section 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 5 in the name of Alex Cole-Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 31. Alex Cole-Hamilton, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 49 in the name of Emma Harper, already debated with Amendment 8. Emma Harper, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 49 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yes.
The question is that Section 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 34 in the name of Gillian Mackay, already debated with Amendment 31. Gillian Mackay, to move or not move?
Move, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 35 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 6. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Excuse me, I not move, Convener.
Thank you. Call Amendment 36 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 6. The Minister, to move formally.
Moved, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 36 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 37 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 6. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Not move, Convener.
Call Amendment 38 in the name of Sandesh Gohani, already debated with Amendment 6. Sandesh Gohani, to move or not move?
Move.
Moved. Thank you. The question is that Amendment 38 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The committee is not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of the amendment, please raise your hand. Those against? Abstentions? The result of the division for Amendment 38 is 4, 2, against 7, and there were no abstentions. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed to. The question is that Section 11 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Section 10, sorry.
10.
Apologies.
That's Section 10. Section 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 39 in the name of Gillian Mackay, group with Amendments 50 and 58. Gillian Mackay to move Amendment 39 and to speak to all amendments in the group.
Thanks, Convener. As I acknowledged in the Stage 1 debate, it is right, given the complex and challenging issues that this bill raises, that in this instance we provide for a post-legislative review. My Amendment 39 seeks to achieve that. I'm also grateful for the consideration Tess White and Rachel Hamilton have given this matter. I note that there are some differences between our approaches. Both Ms White and Ms Hamilton have opted for annual reviews, in contrast to the more standard approach I've taken of an initial review 2 years after the bill comes into force and every 5 years thereafter. It's my expectation that these reviews should not be light touch or tick box exercise, but rather should be in-depth consideration of the legislation's impact and effectiveness. The timings I chose reflect this, because these reviews will have implications both for staff time and on the public purse. I also think it's important that the bill is given time to bed in so that the impacts of safe access zones can be fairly evaluated. However, I also recognise that members may feel that the significance of the issues raised by safe access zones requires something more regular. Whilst I'm currently concerned by the implications of an annual review, if my amendment is agreed today, I'd be very happy to explore with Ms White and Ms Hamilton if any changes to timings of the reviews are possible ahead of Stage 3. I also note that the amendments lodged by Ms White and Ms Hamilton do not require the reports to be laid before Parliament and only require them to be published. My amendment requires the report to be published and laid before Parliament, and I think this offers greater transparency and accountability. Likewise, I note that there's considerable difference in the specificity of my amendment and Ms White's. As I've said, I share her desire to ensure that these reviews are robust, but I'm also sensitive to the risk of being overly prescriptive, so that the detail required removes the opportunity to gather a fuller and more informative picture. Again, if my amendment is agreed to, I'd be very, very willing to discuss this issue with Ms White ahead of Stage 3. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton to speak to Amendment 50 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Similar to Gillian Mackay's Amendment 39, my Amendment 50 requires ministers to publish a report on the effectiveness of safe access zones each year. As per an earlier amendment of mine, it draws examples from the Northern Ireland Bill, and former MLA Claire Bailey described how her and her colleagues approached the bill, which was attractive to my Scottish Parliament colleagues and seemed to be an elegant solution to what we're trying to achieve here. I do believe this amendment improves Parliament's ability to scrutinise the effectiveness of the bill and increases accountability. However, I do recognise that Gillian Mackay has pointed out that her amendment requires the report to be laid before Parliament. Gillian Mackay, as she has pointed out, has a different timescale, being over 2 years rather than a year, as per Tess White's and my amendment. I do believe that hers looks at a broader view and is not specific as mine, and considering that the bill seeks to ensure that women can access healthcare without fear and harassment, I believe mine would be more targeted to the outcomes. I do thank Gillian Mackay for saying that she will work with both Tess White, my colleague Tess White, and me on this specific amendment if hers passes. I do believe that Ms. White's amendment is complementary to both of these amendments, but it does seek to gather wider information on a broader set of metrics. So hopefully we can achieve something that is positive for this bill to ensure that the bill works. And just lastly, convener, on the point that Gillian Mackay made around the timescale of 2 years, I do think it's slightly contradictory to what Gillian Mackay was trying to argue previously around the need to be fleet of foot when recognising extending or reducing the zone measurements, because we need to be live to the situation. And I think that if we had this reporting mechanism in a year rather than 2 years, it would actually show Parliament the picture on the ground at the time. But I do understand your comments around being reflexive.
Tess White to speak to Amendment 58 and the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I also, like my colleague Rachel Hamilton, welcome Gillian Mackay's suggestion to engage with us on this. It is very important to, as Gillian Mackay says, to make this bill robust. But I just want to say a few words in advance of hopefully meeting Gillian Mackay with Rachel Hamilton. So the committee, when we sat down, we were clear that paragraph 7 and 22 in the Stage 1 report, that this legislation should be subject to regular an ongoing review, and we've just discussed now that in terms of the timing that might be different. So if we could talk about that. And I think I'd just like to take the committee back to the reasoning regarding this, and to quote, to ensure restrictions continue to be proportionate to the legitimate aims of the bill as circumstances change over time. So when legislation like this seeks to address the balance of rights, and this is about the balance of rights between different groups, key point of this amendment is that regular post-legislative review is crucial, and building something in to make sure it's robust is really important. And so, as I've said, Rachel Hamilton and I do welcome Gillian Mackay's willingness to include the post-legislative review provision at stage 2, which is covered in Amendment 39. But my concern is that an initial review period of 2 years, then followed by 5 years increments, doesn't really go far enough towards meeting the committee's recommendations in this regard. So when we do meet, I'd like to test that further. So Amendment 58 calls for an annual review, which I think does make it more robust. It draws from the committee's recommendations as well as Section 8 of Northern Ireland's Abortion Services Safe Access Zones Act 2023, which comprehensively covers areas such as the effectiveness of the legislation in achieving its aims, as well as the impact on those engaged in protests and vigils. And we've talked about that earlier in this meeting. But what it also does, it seeks regular reporting on the number of arrests, prosecutions, convictions under the Act, and its ongoing compliance with the Human Rights Act 1998, which has been mentioned before. It seeks input from key stakeholders, such as Police Scotland, health boards, local authorities, and it gives Scottish ministers flexibility to consult in this regard. And I think having a checklist of who the key stakeholders as a matter of course is very, very important to enshrine that into the bill. So these points are all covered by paragraph 7 and 22 of the committee's stage 1 report on the bill. So I'm not trying to be prescriptive, but I am trying to capture as much information as possible to ensure this legislation is effective over the longer term. So in consideration of what Gillian Mackay said, that Gillian Mackay is willing to meet with Rachel Hamilton and I, then I will withdraw this amendment, but seek to hopefully come up with a form of wording that is mutually agreeable. Thank you.
Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to place a few points on the record in this section on reporting review, which other members have indicated is so important in the way in which the bill actually functions in our communities. So we had looked carefully at all of these amendments and absolutely understand why they have been brought here today. I'm very heartened by the discussion that's just taken place in terms of the debate. Our intention had been to support Gillian Mackay's amendment 39, but ask for the government to work with the other members in this section. Thank you.
Minister.
I will be brief. I echo what Ms Mackay has said. I believe her Amendment 39 responds to the Stage 1 recommendations by providing a robust and comprehensive review that will also give Parliament its place and make its findings public. If I may address Rachel Hamilton's point about a two-year reporting period and Ms White as well. The two-year reporting period would not prevent action being taken in the meantime to extend or reduce zones as needed. And also I would just gently point out that ministers always keep legislation under review. That's an ongoing process. So I urge members to support Amendment 39 and vote for it. And I also extend an offer to discuss further with Ms Hamilton and Ms White if they feel their intentions are not met by Ms Mackay's amendment. I'll finish there. Thanks. Before my voice disappears.
Gillian Mackay to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 39.
Thanks, Convener, and I want to thank everyone for their contribution to this this set of amendments. I appreciate Rachel Hamilton's earlier comments around that potential look of a contradiction between trying to move quickly to react to scenarios versus taking our time for review. For me, there are two main times of year when there's a large amount of activity happening at these sites, taking too few of them into account and allowing for that behavioural change to potentially happen, I think potentially reduces the level of scrutiny we might be able to take in a post-legislative setting. So that's why I believe the 2 years is better than a year. And again, we'll happily cover this in a conversation. Absolutely.
I completely agree. I think it's a difficult landscape right now because we don't know how other legislation is working so far in other legislators. And it would have been useful. But of course, this is so brand new that we have to sort of take this approach. And I completely appreciate what she's saying.
No, absolutely. And I appreciate the arguments made for the year review as well. My other concern around the yearly review is the burden that places on committees in particular. It would likely come back to Health Committee to do that. And given how crowded the work programme for committees often is, it could potentially displace other pieces of work. Again, others may have a contradictory or a contrary view to that particular argument. I think it is, as Rachel Hamilton reflects, a difficult landscape. I don't know if Tess White's looking to come in.
Thank you. If I can just ask a question. So I welcome this thank you. I welcome the spirit that Gillian Mackay and the Minister are willing to engage on this important point. So in terms of, is Gillian Mackay open to looking at this with Rachel Hamilton and I? Is there sort of an open mind, or is there slight sort of, how much wiggle room is there in this, just to give a view? Are you willing to look at it completely openly?
Absolutely willing to look at it. I think I wanted to respond to the comments that Rachel Hamilton had made and set out why I believe what I brought forward was the right way to do it, and more than happy to explore in a more conversation space where we can have a longer discussion time. What it is that people are looking for.
And thank you, Gillian Mackay, because I think going back to the substance of the committee's report is important in this respect. So thank you.
No, absolutely. For the for all of these reasons that I've outlined, I move my amendment 39 and hope the committee will support it in light of the really constructive conversation we've had. I hope that Ms White and Ms Hamilton will not press their amendments. If they do, I would ask committee to vote against them. And I, again, recommit to meeting both Ms Hamilton and Ms White to explore what other steps we could take to strengthen the bill ahead of stage three.
The question is that Amendment 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 50 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 39. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 58 in the name of Tess White, already debated with Amendment 39. Tess White to move or not move?
Not move, Convener.
The question is that Section 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 40 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 8. Minister to move formally?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 41 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 8. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Sections 14 to 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed? And that ends stage two consideration of the bill. At our meeting next week, we will have a session with stakeholders to consider NHS waiting times, and we'll start phase two of our post-legislative scrutiny of Social Care Self-Directed Support Scotland Act 2013. And that concludes our meeting today.